to learn about whether or not I photographed and about grooming and makeup and all that. And
you learned very well.
I had
she certainly does.
Thank you. And then I had a series of auditions at NBC. I grew up in New York, so that was
that's
handy.
Where you're actually from. New York.
Yeah, and they had what they called a dramatic staff on radio at NBC. And after many auditions, I finally got word that I had survived them all and was now on their dramatic staff, available for casting. And it was such a frustration to have to call them up and say, thank you, and I hope, well, maybe I'll be back, but I'm off to California. So I never did get to do any broadcasting on the dramatic staff for NBC. But that's sound, camera, and acting. There were just three separate studies.
But your first film, you were with Lana Turner. You did a movie with Lana. What was that?
It was Lana's very first lead.
It was Lana's first lead?
Yeah.
What was that movie?
It was a very good picture.
It was called The Glamour Girls.
These Glamour Girls.
Those?
These. It was actually, I think, set in Princeton College. They called it Kingston, not Princeton. But it was about an Ivy League college weekend house party. Still in the tail end of the Depression, with all these dewy-eyed young debutantes of fine family and ruined fortunes, looking for a suitable mate, and all of them husband shopping at the house party. And Lana was the exception. She was from a dance hall, and getting her discomfort in the midst of these sometimes snobbish girls was the main theme. Lou Ayres, Richard Carlson, let's see, Lana, Ann Rutherford, Anita Louise.
What a cast.
There were about 12 of us, six and six. I committed suicide in that, and it started a whole good career for me of really meaty acting parts. So I was very grateful to these Glamour Girls.
How many pictures have you done, Rosemary?
Rosemary
DeCamp, every time I turn on the tube, I mean, I see the movies. You've done
45 years, you know.
45 years?
An awful lot of television and series and one-shots.
Dr. Christian, that's first.
I was very lucky in the early films. Martha Scott got me into Cheers for Miss Bishop. I was playing, I was 30 then. I was a professor in college before I ever got a paying job.
But you're always playing the mothers, the beautiful mothers.
I know, but
mothers,
you see, it was because I was so long in the tooth at that point.
At 30.
At 30, playing the mothers.
I started out with no hopes of, you know, there was no dream of Juliet. I played Mercutio in college and Clytemnestra, but there was
it's
no
a great
Juliet.
Part, Mercutio.
Yeah. And
you did Ronald Reagan. You did two movies with Ronald.
Yes, I did. This is the Army. I was George Murphy's wife and Ronnie's mother.
And Ronald Reagan's mother.
We are 6 months apart in age, and I'm a little older, 6 months older. Then one of them was he had epilepsy, and you couldn't even say seizure or anything then. So. The picture sort of died because nobody can understand why Ron was having little fits and things. They had forgotten to read the novel before they bought it.
You know, my favorite movie Ronald Reagan ever did was King's Road.
Yes. I think that was splendid.
That was a good one.
A great movie.
Losing the Dagenau.
Betty Fields.
If you lose one of your members, I think it makes an impression. That will stay in people's minds. No.
Rosemary DeCamp, tell me about the radio days.
Oh, the radio days. Oh, well.
I mean, those are the days when you started in Hollywood on Dr. Christian.
Well, I started in New York. My first job in New York was Easy Aces with Goodman Ace. And I had a boyfriend who was an engineer, and he took me in. And Goodman was so marvelous, so funny, you know. I thought Easy Aces was a bridge show, you know, not realizing his wit or having read his works, but they were darling to me. And from then on, I went on and did a lot of shows. I worked with Orson and, you know, all those.
Orson Welles.
Yeah, I think I did, now W.O.R., The Shadow.
And,
you did The Shadow.
So I ran around, we did funnies on Saturday morning with Agnes Moorhead, and we'd get $15 for doing the funnies. You got. It was great. It was like going to the gym. You could play all
of
kinds
course.
Of parts, you know.
And very broadly.
No director to tell you to tone it down, you know. So, and then I came back out here and started Dr. Christian, which was...
With Lionel Barrymore.
With, Gene Herschel.
Gene Herschel, I'm sorry.
And 17 years and four children and marriage and so in that 17 years. Rather full, but I also was doing television and films at the same time.
I see.
Which made it difficult. Running off, always had to do a show. At 3 o'clock, we had to do two, one for the East and one for the West then.
Mm-hmm. And, oh, that's right.
So I was always in the movie, you know, crying over my son who was doing something on the stage.
Uh-huh.
And the assistant director, of course, loathed that kind of thing because they had to pull you out. And I was usually pregnant and I was sick and had to get over the hill to do the show at 3 o'clock. Enough of radio.
Uh-huh. Tell me, James Craig, do you still see him? Yeah, all those great movies you've done
James
with him.
James has left us.
He did? Oh, did he? I didn't know that.
I think in the last 2 or 3 years.
Has he?
Yeah. I haven't seen him for many years. Uh-huh. Yeah.
And Margaret O'Brien, tell me about her.
Oh, I do see Margaret.
You do see Margaret?
Oh. She's a lovely woman.
Yeah. How many films have you done with Margaret?
I did two with her.
Two.
And I thought she was an enchanted child. She had as pure an instinct, I think, as a child actress as I've ever seen.
Do we have that today? Now, I want to ask you that. Do you think we have a child actress out there like Marsha Hunt?
I think there probably are a number of them. Uh-huh. Kids are awfully gifted. We need to find the ones with that gift, but I think they're all over the place. I see such good performances on television. There's tremendous turnover.
Are you happy what's happening today of our business, of show business?
Wretched. I'm wretched.
Tell
I'm
me.
In mourning.
Uh-huh.
Oh, there are some good ones.
Oh, of course.
Yes,
of course.
But the material,
you pick
the material.
Two or three
it's
a year, you can.
That's about it.
But that's the material. Don't you think that's important? That's
it's all like important.
It
I'm a writer's wife.
That's right. You were married to a writer. Tell
I still
me
am. It'll be 40 years in another 10 days.
That's right. Oh. Her husband is a scriptwriter.
Yes.
And his name was?
Rob. Still
his,
is.
Yes, sorry.
Robert Presnell,
Robert,
Jr.
Uh-huh. Is he still writing?
Oh, yes. I see his name on
you
there.
You do?
Yeah.
Good.
You do? What things has he done lately?
Mostly feature films and television, movies for television. He did a few series scripts, but they're so prescribed. They have to be so in the formula of a series that it was much freer work to do the movies, which are longer. You know, the two-hour things give you a much better chance to develop.
Yes. 27 minutes, you can't tell much.
Yeah. That's right. Yeah.
The Bob Cummings Show. Tell me about the Bob Cummings Show.
Oh, that was
show.
Great. We had so much fun.
Did you? How many
so
years
fast.
Were you on the Bob Cummings Show?
Oh, five.
5 years?
Mm, five
he was my
seasons,
first leading
anyway.
Man.
Was he?
Really?
Bob Cummings was.
I did three with him at Paramount.
Wow, you're not
but
that
tell,
old.
Oh, at least, at least. Tell about the show.
Yes.
Well,
show.
You know, great director. When he finally got around to the fact that he got rid of the other directors and directed and played the star himself, you know, there was one camera for Bob, and there was a longer camera for the rest of us, and then sometimes there'd be an insert. We had a cameraman who, the show finally killed him. He was whipping those crews around like whips, you know. And but it was marvelous fun and great people. But last, we were still laughing at the jokes and we did it. And Bob had a marvelous way of using the time for lighting. You know, that's what kills you in pictures, is waiting.
Yeah. Waiting,
he always had three rehearsals going. There was the white one, and then there was the pink one, and then there was the one for blood. And those three had to take place before they ever cranked the film, because they want to save it. This is economical, this
well,
show,
of course.
And save the film. And when we went in there, the takes were all, look, yeah, you know, everybody knew just what they were doing.
Very good.
But we were still laughing. They were wonderful scripts. Paul Henning wrote the scripts.
I see.
And I think
Gordon McRae. Tell me about, I love that movie, Silver Lining.
Silver Lining, there were two of those.
Two,
were Penrod stories.
Yes,
you know.
There were two of them, yes.
Two of them.
By the Silvery Moon?
So, yes.
Yes, I love that. This is one.
Darling, darling boy, Gordon
McRae.
So dear.
We just lost him, and this is the movie. I love that movie.
You
this
lost.
Is,
I don't know
that's
if that's
June
the
Haver.
One.
Yes.
No, that's June Haver.
June Haver, with By the Silvery Light.
I don't
light.
Think Gordy was in that one. I think it was
Yes, Gordon McRae was in this.
Was he?
Yes, definitely. There he
where
is.
Where right is he? Those are the twins.
There is Gordon McRae. Gordon McRae.
Looks like,
Here we are. There we
There we go.
There's Gordon McRae right there.
And Mary Wicks, marvelous. And Doris Day.
Doris Day.
Right. Get letters from her. Her show's on cable somewhere.
She has a talk show now. She's
really
doing very well. Yes.
Animals.
Oh, good.
Dogs.
Yes.
Good.
Well, it's talk, I love
Darling
it.
Darling woman. She's great affirmative person.
She must be. I've never met her. No.
Her,
but I love her work.
She before a scene, she'd go into with, she'd get out the Mary Baker Eddy book and work herself into the scene, but she had to have that five, maybe 3 minutes to herself. And that was part of her life, her sparkle, that's part of her health.
Rosemary, is this you and Johnny Garfield? Can we get that close? Johnny Garfield, where is this, in the commissary at the school?
We did a thing called Pride of the Marines.
Pride of the Marines. Yes. That was a great movie.
But I love Johnny.
Yes. What kind of guy was he? Really?
He was wonderful. I never will forget the day down at San Diego when he, this is 44, when the, we weren't doing too well, you know, in the Pacific. And the men were coming in without eyes, without legs and arms. And he was just, he was tired. He was supposed to be blind. He says, God, I'm a fake. I'm just a fake. And they're all bleeding and they've lost their legs. And what do they think of me? It really tore him up. But he was awfully good in the part.
Marsha Hunt has a thing you always, you know, I've known it, you all, every time I pick up the paper, charity, you're a lady of charities, you help people.
Stars in your crown.
Yeah, she is just a lovely lady, and you are right now in the Valley doing a thing for homeless.
Try.
You are the mayor for the homeless, you started this. You are the president of this organization.
Yeah.
You are helping the homeless people in America in the Valley.
Tell us, what are you
Tell
doing?
Us about
what
this.
What kind of places can you get for them?
That's the big problem. We have thousands of homeless people just in the San Fernando Valley and no facilities. See, the Valley's brand new. It sprang up as of and since World War II, and nobody dreamed of hard times.
Who are they, these people? Who are these
They're
people?
Everything. They're veterans still haunted by Vietnam. They're deserted wives and mothers. There are whole families living in cars and vans, if they still have them. They're older people who couldn't handle the latest rent hike, who are living on fixed retirement pensions. They're certainly some alcoholics and drug-addicted people, but so many runaway teenagers, many pregnant youngsters of all kinds, and many of them are just people who were let go during the recession and haven't been able to connect with another job since.
Why aren't they on welfare?
Or if they do, do you know there are a lot of the working poor who are there, they have jobs, but they're so low paying that they can never get ahead enough money to pay the first and last months and the security amounts.
Yes, that's it.
Rent for a new place. So they live in their cars and they shower and clean up at the Y, and where they work, nobody knows they're homeless. We're trying to do is to get facilities and services rolling, and now after 2 years of really hanging in there, there are three facilities soon to open. One will be for the homeless mentally ill, and I didn't mention that.
They are letting them out of the institutions, and they are on the streets.
That's it.
They've been doing that
for at least 10 years.
Do you blame
years.
Our government for doing this?
It was well-intentioned, Skippy. The thought was that the people in our state institutions were really just being warehoused. They weren't getting the kind of treatment and cure that they deserved, and so they were on sedation, and some of them, you know, there were some pretty bad facilities. And the thought was, let's get them back to their home communities where their families and their friends and familiar places will help the restoring process with community services. The problem was the communities were not funded, they were not prepared, and the families that couldn't afford to take or couldn't hack taking back a mental invalid into their lives left the homeless wandering the streets, the most vulnerable of all the homeless, the prey to gangs and muggers, whatever. But now there's going to be a place in the Valley where they can get not only housing but treatment. And
so we are doing something about it.
We're starting, but there's a long way to go. What we have to do is to change people's attitudes. They're so fearful of the unknown. You know, that was the trouble with the civil rights movement. People didn't know people of a different skin color or racial background, and therefore they feared them.
Yes.
Now they're learning there was nothing to fear.
Yes.
But it took laws to force integration of schools and housing and so on. Well, once the residents, the people with homes, realize that the homeless themselves need protection. It isn't the people in neighborhoods who need protection from the homeless, it's the other way around.
Of course.
Then maybe they'll accept them. But these are not criminals. These are people who are victims of their own bad planning or the economy or their emotions. And there they are up against it and in a kind of state of shock that this could happen to them. And they need understanding, they need a new chance. We house, we feed, we clothe our criminals. And we do nothing for our homeless. So it's time we did better than that.
And you started this in the Valley, and so it's called the Valley
Mayor's Fund. It's called the Valley Mayor's Fund. The communities of the Valley have a lot of honorary mayors. I'm one of them. And I thought maybe if we pull them all together, we could get a sense of this, like a patchwork quilt, all these communities of the Valley under the auspices of the mayors. And it's also the real mayors, Tom Bradley.
Tom, and I see you have Steve
Edwards
here.
Is the mayor of
Los Angeles. The founder. Yeah, he is the mayor.
That's such great work.
That is wonderful.
It's dogged. It's around the clock. And I had no idea how complex, how sensitive.
You have to go to meetings with citizens.
I live at meetings.
She lives, yes. You and Beverly Garland's in it, too, I understand.
Beverly was one of the founding mayors, Actually, there are only four honorary mayors on the board.
I see.
But we have the endorsement and encouragement of all the rest.
Yes, I think that's great, Marsha.
That's really
There'll be a place for homeless women with children. And that's only a daytime place, but at least there'll be a place where they can take a shower. The first thing they want is to get clean. Because that's part of self-respect. And living, you know, on the grass and under bushes and in doorways and under freeways does not give you much self-respect.
We have a lot of homeless in America, don't we? This country
I think it's millions.
It's millions, yes.
Yeah. Several million, probably.
San Francisco, they're all sleeping in the streets and... You know,
we need
the richest country in the world.
Precisely.
The richest country in the world, and we help others, but we don't help ourselves.
Well, I don't want to get political. Let's move on to something else.
Yeah, right, Rosemary. Rosemary DeCamp, look at this. This is you and Yankee
Doodle Dandy. That's when they get out of the parking lot and that cute
Yeah, I love that, with James Cagney and...
I look like some kind of a monolith over there on the line.
I love it. This is from Dr. Christian.
Oh, yes, yes.
I love that. That's great.
That was fun. I wasn't in the picture, but never mind.
Here's Orson Welles.
Yeah, I'm fat and he's skinny, isn't that great?
Orson Welles. I love that.
I'm pregnant and he's thin. We were doing a Lux Radio Theater. I look like Ethel Merman, don't you think?
What kind of guy Orson Welles was?
Very complex and very witty.
He had
and funny and kind of a realist, too. Extraordinarily competent and imaginative in what he wanted to do. I really didn't work with him that much. I worked with him in radio. He never chose me for any of his movies.
My husband directed him on a radio show, if anyone can direct Orson Welles. That was Robert's assignment out here, and it was through Orson that Robert and I met.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah, so how many times have you been married?
We have him to thank. Pardon me?
How many times have you been married?
Once before.
Once before. Yeah. And you, Rosemary?
Just once, 45 years.
45 years. How many children do you have?
Four.
You have four children. Are they in the business, any of them?
Two of them worked in it, and then they lost interest and went into other things. I was happy that they did. Because I don't think, I really, what do you think?
Your father.
Very harrowing profession.
Tell me about your father, Marsha Hunt.
Your father,
yes.
He was the most gentle man I ever knew. He was a lawyer. He was a brilliant scholar. He went into law and then the legal branch of insurance. And then ultimately, because this new phenomenon, Social Security, that came into our land, needed a knowledge of law and insurance. So my father was offered New York City, which was the plum of the nation, and he turned it down for Los Angeles to be near me, because I was still a minor, just started at Paramount in pictures, so that the family could be together. So he managed the L.A. office and then created the Hollywood office of Social Security.
He started the Social Security.
And he, yes, he led that. He went on radio a great deal, explaining it to people, because it was a new, wonderful thing.
I would like to know one thing about Robert Young. Tell me about Robert Young. Love Robert Young.
I don't know that there's anything to tell that people don't already either know or sense about Bob. He's a highly intelligent, giving, caring, gifted man. Uh-huh. And we did a picture, in the 40s, called Joe Smith American, and then I did one of his TV shows.
That was in 1942.
Could have been. I don't know which of the 40 years. Uh-huh. It was during the war.
You were doing films in the 30s and the 40s.
I started 50 years ago. How's that?
50 years ago.
Imagine.
Lovely.
Yeah.
Lovely.
Doesn't feel like 50.
But one of my favorite movies you did was with Brandon DeWile and Carol Lindley, Blue Denim.
Blue Denim.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
You were just...
It's a good play.
You were the mother in that.
I was the somewhat flighty but caring mother. Uh-huh. And that was a rather brave film for the 50s.
Because
it had to do with the...
1959.
The pregnant teenager.
Tell me about that, those days. I mean...
Well, it was considered pretty brave to make that film and to deal with a 16-year-old pregnancy and Brandon, the father. And what the film resolved with their deciding to have the child, but abortion was certainly mentioned and was considered, but it was unthinkable.
Yes.
Now, abortion is very much considered as the way to prevent a child from having to bear a child and to get on with her education and discovering who she is and planning her family.
Yes.
Which is far better way.
Brandon DeWilde, he was a good actor. It's a shame that he what happened.
I forget what killed Brandon. Was it an accident, an illness?
Yes, he had a car accident.
He was so dear that I wrote a poem when he had a birthday while we were shooting, and I remember, by the way, he had a different pronunciation. It was DeWilde.
DeWilde.
Brandon DeWilde certainly filled a need I had for a teenage lad, but it goes on and on with many, many verses about being his temporary mother.
Oh, I see.
He was a darling. He and Carol had a...
Carol Lindley.
Had her on the show. Short romance. They used to come over and play tennis.
Yeah, she told me,
they're darlings.
Yeah, I understand. You were in hotel. You just did a hotel thing.
I was on hotel last year.
Last year.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Are you busy doing things now, Rosemary? Are you up for anything?
Well, the hardest work of all, Skip, is at home. And I have a big house and a big family, and I work hard at home.
Do you live in Hollywood area?
A lot of copper enamel. That's my out.
Copper.
Yes.
Mm.
Really?
Yeah. Well, I've done it for years, and it's quite an escape for me.
Uh-huh.
Also, I write.
Yes.
And you write all the time.
Children's books. She wrote a child's book. I love it. Tell me a name of the children's book.
Well, it was a dull title. They picked the title, you know. It's called Here Duke. Dull, you know. But it was a dog we got at the pound. And
that's
how
it. Can I show? There's the picture.
Never got over being hungry.
Isn't that beautiful? I love it.
Oh, well.
I love it.
So but I love pets and love... Get a lot of. We have one now that's extraordinary. We have to spell in front of her.
Oh, understands too well.
Uh-huh. Yes, you know, you have to say WALK and get the LEASH.
Probably teaching to spell.
She's
that bright.
She worked in pictures, I think, because she responds to hand signals and has been debarked.
Really?
And I think they do that sometimes. Is that right?
I didn't know.
I think so.
Two great ladies, tell me something. Directors in Hollywood, your favorite directors. What's most fun you had with people you worked with on the sets, your directors? Tell me.
I never loved a director more than Fred Zinnemann.
Really?
In whose first feature picture I was. Uh-huh. They just celebrated his tremendous singular career. Uh-huh. I think he may be the most gifted, caring director I ever came across. And the other favorite was Jules Dassin, who went on to France to do all those wonderful things with Melina Mercouri and
wonderful,
so on.
Yes.
But Julie and I did two comedies at MGM, and then Julie directed the first play I did on Broadway, and I felt safe doing it because I was in his hands.
How long were you at MGM?
Well, it spanned 7 years,
but
I was under contract about six, I think it was. Yeah.
Rosemary. Warner Brothers, those days.
Oh, I
favorite directors.
Dave Butler,
tell me.
Mike Curtiz, and Paramount, Mitch Leisen. That darling there.
Hollywood has changed nowadays, hasn't
it?
Yes,
I think the trouble is it doesn't come out of one mind, or even two or three minds. Yeah. No, it comes out of a whole lot of committee.
Too many.
Everything's made up by a committee.
It's too many?
dromedaries.
You mean it was used to be out of one mine in Hollywood?
Well, the great ones, the good ones, came out of two or three, isn't that right?
Yes, I agree. But it came out of knowing minds. And now we have, I think, children making pictures for children.
Yes.
And it would be nice to restore it to the grown-ups.
Yeah. The cartoons, you know.
That's what Hollywood's gone to.
The people are cartoons. And, but it's all directors don't know what they're doing.
I was a young child watching movies, and I always wanted to watch actresses, older actresses, good stories. And I was only 12. Yeah. But what happened?
Well, then you're different.
It's not different. It's my era has changed. It's just I used to go to movies and I wanted to see King's Row at 12 years old. Now what happened?
It's on cartoons. They were darling to me, and from then on, I went on and did a lot of shows. I worked with Orson and, you know, all those.
Orson Welles.
Yeah, I think I did. Now, W.O.R., The Shadow.
Oh, yes. And, you did The Shadow.
So I ran around. We did funnies on Saturday morning with Agnes Moorhead, and we'd get $15 for doing the funnies. It was great. It was like going to the gym. You could play all kinds of parts, you know.
And very broadly.
No director to tell you to tone it down, you know. So, and then I came back out here and started Dr. Christian, which was...
With Lionel Barrymore.
Gene Herschel.
Gene Herschel, I'm sorry.
And 17 years and four children and marriage and so in that 17 years. Rather full, but I also was doing television and films at the same time.
I see.
Which made it difficult. Running off, always had to do a show. At 3 o'clock, we had to do two, one for the East and one for the West then. And so I was always in the movie, you know, crying over my son who was doing something on the stage. And the assistant director, of course, loathed that kind of thing because they had to pull you out. And I was usually pregnant and I was sick and had to get over the hill to do the show at 3 o'clock. Enough of radio.
Tell me, James Craig, do you still see him? Yeah, all those great movies you've done
James
with him.
James has left us.
He did? Oh, did he? I didn't know that.
I think in the last two or three years.
Has he?
I haven't seen him for many years.
Margaret O'Brien, tell me about her.
Oh, I do see Margaret.
You do see Margaret?
Oh, she's a lovely woman.
Yeah. How many films have you done with Margaret?
I did two with her.
Two?
And I thought she was an enchanted child. She had as pure an instinct, I think, as a child actress as I've ever seen.
Do we have that today? Now, I want to ask you that. Do you think we have a child actress out there like Marsha Hunt?
I think there probably are a number of them. Kids are awfully gifted. We need to find the ones with that gift, but I think they're all over the place. I see such good performances on television. This tremendous turnover.
Are you happy what's happening today of our business, of show business?
Wretched. I'm wretched.
Tell me.
In mourning.
Oh, there are some good ones. Made,
of course.
Yes, but the material.
You pick
the material.
Two or three
it's
a year. You can.
That's about it.
But that's the material. Don't you think that's important?
It's all important. I'm a writer's wife.
That's right. You were married to a writer.
I still am. It'll be 40 years in another. And Lana was the exception. She was from a dance hall. And getting her discomfort in the midst of these sometimes snobbish girls was the main theme. Lou Ayres, Richard Carlson, let's see, Lana, Ann Rutherford, Anita Louise.
What a cast.
There were about 12 of us. Six and six. I committed suicide in that, and it started a whole good career for me of really meaty acting parts. So I was very grateful to these glamour girls.
How many pictures have you done, Rosemary?
Rosemary
DeCamp, every time I turn on the tube, I see the movies. You've done 40, many.
45 years, you know. And
45 years?
An awful lot of television and series and one-shots.
Dr. Christian. Let's first.
I was very lucky in the early films. Martha Scott got me into Cheers for Miss Bishop. I was 30 then. I was a professor in college before I ever got a paying job.
But you're always playing the mothers, the beautiful mothers.
I know, but you see, it was because
young.
I was so long in the tooth at that point.
At 30.
At 30.
I started out with no hopes of, you know, there was no dream of Juliet. I played Mercutio in college and Clytemnestra, but there was no Juliet.
It's a great part, Mercutio.
You did Ronald Reagan. You did two movies with Ronald?
Yes, I did This is the Army. I was George Murphy's wife? And Ronnie's mother.
And Ronald Reagan's mother.
We are 6 months apart in age. Uh-huh. And I'm a little older, 6 months older. Uh-huh. Then one of them was he had epilepsy, and you couldn't even say seizure or anything then. So the picture sort of died because nobody can understand why Ronald was having little fits and things. Uh-huh. They had forgotten to read the novel before they bought it.
You know, my favorite movie Ronald Reagan ever did was King's Road.
Yes. I think that was splendid.
A great movie. Betty Fields.
If you lose one of your members, I think it makes an impression that will stay in people's minds. No.
Rosemary DeCamp, tell me about the radio days.
Oh, the radio Hollywood days. Oh, well.
I mean, those are the days when you started in Hollywood on
Dr.
Christian.
Well, I started in New York. My first job in New York was Easy Aces with Goodman Ace. I had a boyfriend who was an engineer, and he took me in. And Goodman was so marvelous, so funny, you know. I thought Easy Aces was a bridge show, you know, not realizing his wit or having read it.
For 10 days.
That's right. Her husband is a scriptwriter.
Yes.
And his name was?
Robert Presnell, Jr.
Is he still writing?
Oh, yes, I see his name on
You
things.
Do?
Yeah.
You do? What things has he done lately?
Mostly feature films and television, movies for television. He did a few series scripts, but they're so prescribed. They have to be so in the formula of a series that it was much freer work to do the movies, which are longer. You know, the two-hour things give you a much better chance to develop.
27 minutes, you can't tell much.
Yeah. That's right. Yeah.
The Bob Cummings Show. Tell me about the Bob Cummings Show.
Oh, that was great. We had so much fun.
Did you? How many years were you on the Bob Cummings Show?
Oh, five.
5 years?
Mm, five. He was my first leading man.
Was he?
Bob Cummings was.
I did three with him at Paramount.
Wow, you're not but that tell, old.
Oh, at least, at least. Tell about the show.
Yes.
Well, show. You know, great director. When he finally got around to the fact that he got rid of the other directors and directed and played the star himself, you know, there was one camera for Bob, and there was a longer camera for the rest of us, and then sometimes there'd be an insert. We had a cameraman who, the show finally killed him. He was whipping those crews around like whips, you know. And but it was marvelous fun and great people. Last, we were still laughing at the jokes and we did it. And Bob had a marvelous way of using the time for lighting. You know, that's what kills you in pictures, is waiting.
Yeah. Waiting,
he always had three rehearsals going. There was the white one, and then there was the pink one, and then there was the one for blood. And those three had to take place before they ever cranked the film, because they want to save it. This is economical, this
well,
show.
Of course.
And save the film. And when we went in there, the takes were all, everybody knew just what they were doing.
Very good.
But we were still laughing. They were wonderful scripts. Paul Henning wrote the scripts.
I see.
And I think...
Gordon McRae. Tell me about... I love that movie, Silver Lining.
Silver Lining. There were two of those.
Two. By
Penrod
the Silver
stories.
Yes,
know.
There were two of them. Yes.
Two of them.
By the Silvery Moon.
So yes.
Yes, I love that. This is one.
Darling boy, Gordon was
McRae.
So dear.
We just lost him, and this is the movie. I love that movie.
You
this
lost.
Is.
I don't know.
That's
June Haver.
Yes.
No, that's Gene Haver.
June Haver with By the Silvery Light.
I don't think Gordy was in that one. I think it was.
Yes, Gordon McRae was in this.
Was he?
Yes, definitely. There
where
he is.
Where is he? Those
there
are the twins.
There is Gordon McRae. Gordon
well,
McRae,
looks like
Here we are. There we
there
are.
We go.
There's Gordon McRae right there.
And Mary Wicks, marvelous. And Doris Day.
Doris Day.
Get letters from her. Her show's on cable somewhere.
She has a talk show now. And she's
really
doing very well. Yes.
Animals.
Oh, good.
And dogs.
Yes.
Good.
Lots of talk. I love
darling
it.
Darling woman. She great is. Affirmative person.
She must be.
You
I've
know,
never met her. No.
Her,
but
her,
I love her work.
Before a scene, she'd go into with she'd get out the Mary Baker Eddy book and work herself into the scene. But she had to have that 5, maybe 3 minutes to herself, and that was part of her life, her sparkle. That's part of her health.
Rosemary, is this you and Johnny Garfield?
Yeah.
Tell me, yeah. You. Can we get that close? Johnny Garfield. Where's this in the commissary at the school?
We did a thing called Pride of the Marines.
Pride of the Marines. Yes, that was a great movie.
But I love Johnny.
Yes. What kind of guy was he? Really?
He was wonderful. I never will forget the day down at San Diego when he. This is 44, when the. We weren't doing too well, you know, in the Pacific. And the men were coming in without eyes, without legs and arms. And he was just. He was tired. He was supposed to be blind. You know, he says, God, I'm a fake. I'm a fake. I'm just a fake. And they're all bleeding and they've lost their legs. And what do they think of me? It really tore him up. But he was awfully good in the part.
Marsha Hunt has a thing you always, you know, I've known it all, every time I pick up the paper, charity, you're a lady of charities, you help people.
Stars in your crown.
Yeah, she is just a lovely lady, and you are right now in the Valley doing a thing for homeless.
Try.
You are the mayor for the homeless, you started this. You are the president of this organization.
Yeah.
You are helping the homeless people in America in the Valley.
Tell us, what are you
Tell
doing?
Us about
what
this.
What kind of places can you get for them?
That's the big problem. We have thousands of homeless people just in the San Fernando Valley, and no facilities. See, the Valley's brand new. It sprang up as of and since World War II, and nobody dreamed of hard times.
Who are they, these people? Who are these
They're
people?
Everything. They're veterans still haunted by Vietnam. They're deserted wives and mothers. There are whole families living in cars and vans, if they still have them. There are older people who couldn't handle the latest rent hike, who are living on fixed retirement pensions. There to learn about whether or not I photographed and about grooming and makeup and all that. And
you learned very well.
I had
she certainly does.
Thank you. And then I had a series of auditions at NBC. I grew up in New York, so that was
That's
handy.
Where you're actually from? New York.
Yeah. And they had what they called a dramatic staff on radio at NBC, and after many, many, many auditions, I finally got word that I had survived them all and was now on their dramatic staff available for casting. And it was such a frustration to have to call them up and say, thank you, and I hope, maybe I'll be back, but I'm off to California. So I never did get to do any broadcasting on the dramatic staff for NBC, but that's sound. Camera and acting, there were just three separate studies.
But your first film, you were with Lana Turner. You did a movie with Lana.
It was Lana's very first lead.
It was Lana's first lead?
Yeah.
What was that movie?
It was a very good picture.
It was called The Glamour Girls.
These Glamour Girls. It was actually, I think, set in Princeton. College. They called it Kingston, not Princeton. But it was about an Ivy League college weekend house party, still in the tail end of the Depression, with all these dewy-eyed young debutantes of fine family and ruined fortunes, looking for a suitable mate, and all of them husband shopping at the house party.